Dear students, today we are going to start another very important module on recursion or recursive structure. So in fact, we have learned about the iterations, the repetition, and that repetition can be solved or were solved by us by using loops. So that is one structure of controlling the or executing the repetition. However, the recursion or recursive structure is another way of repeating the same code again and again unless there is a base condition met or there is a termination condition is fulfilled. So in recursive structure, we will be mainly discussing today the binary search algorithm. So we will be implementing binary search algorithm using recursion. So recursion is alternative way of loop paradigm. This also helps to repeat, and then loop execute set of instructions and then again execute set of instruction, then again execute set of instruction, and so on. However, recursion doesn't follow or execute in this matter. Recursion first execute some instructions, and within those instructions, it again execute the set of instructions. Within those instructions, it again execute the set of instructions. So do not be confused. I am going to give you a very simple example. You are having a phone of your friend, and that friend is talking with you. At the same time, you receive another call from your dad. So what you will do? You normally go... You first will tell your friend that there is another call and you should hold. So within that execution of the call with your friend, you are putting that call on hold and you are starting another call with your dad. And once that call is terminated, finished, you are coming back to the call of your friend. So you are actually executing call to a dad or call to a friend two time, but that thing is not in a way as loop executes, that you are not finishing one call first and then you are moving towards second call and finishing that call first. So you are generating or initiating the call within the call. So this means that set of instructions are going to be executed, and that set of instruction will generate another set of instructions of the same function which will be executed repeatedly. So what is a binary search algorithm which we will be following or going to execute using the recursion? So we have, first of all, we have a sorted list of numbers or names at the moment, and we want to search within those sorted lists. So one possibility could be that we start from first element and ends until the last element, as we did with the sequence searching in previous module. However, here as it is already sorted, so this means that you can get to the required information very effectively and efficiently if you follow certain procedure. And that procedure resembles to the procedure when you search a term in the dictionary. So for example, if you want to search the dictionary for orange, so what you will do? You will open the dictionary from a place where O or similar character is mentioned. So for example, you opened it and you identified that on this page there is a D which is mentioned. Then you will move to the right place and leave out the left place. And then when you move to the right, then you found that you have identified a page on which, for example, there is a letter U. So then you found, at the very later stage. So O is somewhere which I have missed. So this means you are leaving the last options are the last pages as well, and you are moving towards the previous list. So this means that you are selecting the dictionary, and then by seeing, then you are saying that whether you should go to the right or you should go to the left. So the binary search algorithm is inspired from this philosophy. So in computer science, we are not seeing with our eyes that we should go to the right or left and from where we should select. So in computer science, we will always select from the middle. So this means you will always open the dictionary from middle, and depending upon your query, you will go either to the left or to the right. So for example, if you go to the right, then that right portion is your actual dictionary. And then you are again selecting from the middle of that sublist and moving forward. So let's have a practical example of seeing that how it happens. We have a original list of all of these persons: Alice, Bob, Carol, David, and so on. And these are basically about 15 names. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Yes, it's 15 names. So we will select the middle name, which is Harry. And we actually wanted to search John. So this is our query. So we will select Harry, and we will see that whether H is greater than J or not. So we found that J should be somewhere in this list. So we ignored the list which is available upward, this one, as we did in the dictionary, and we selected the list Iron, John, Kelly, and so on. And from this list, again, we selected the middle point, which is Larry. And again, we compared Larry with the John, and we identified that the John is less than the Larry, because J, the ASCII code of J is less than the ASCII code of L. So then we are focusing to this list. When we focus this list, we found the middle point, and that is John. As soon as we found the John, we stopped the search. So you have seen that with the sequential search, which we learned some time ago, we might have gone through all of the list by comparing John with all of the members of this list. So there would be 15 comparisons. However, here we have only 1, 2, and in third comparison, we are reaching to the required position, or we are solving the problem. So here is the algorithm, the pseudocode of this algorithm, which says that if list is empty, report that the search is failed already. So this is one condition which we will be learning further in the next module as well. And then we are saying that select the middle entry in the test entry, and if the test entry is equal to the target and value as shown in the previous example about John, so then report that search is successful, and that's it. If the target value is less than the test entry, then you search the portion of list preceding test entry of target value. And if the target value is greater than test entry, then search the portion of the list following the test entry. So we have written the same procedure which we have talked about in the last two slides. And a little bit more formal representation would be like this, that if the list is empty, stop. Then get the middle entry into the test entry. If the test entry is equal to target, it's okay. Otherwise, go to the portion of the preceding. If target value is less than or target value is greater than test entry, then go to the following position. And in each of the position, we are again calling the function which we have defined as search. So in each of the iteration, we are sending it a list and the target value. And in the first time, the list was the actual list of 15 elements. But in the next time, that list will contain only the sublist. So this means after first step, In the previous example, let's have a look on it. So in this step, the search function will have only this as a sublist, not the whole one. And in the next example, only this will be passed as a sublist. So this means at every time we are passing only the sublist to this search function again, and then it is terminating where it finds the list is empty. So we have not talked about the list is empty statement in detail, which we are going to cover in the next module, that how this algorithm will finish. So if we summarize today's module, we have learned about the recursion, and we have seen what is recursive structure, what is binary search algorithm, and we have seen with example that how binary search algorithm works, and then we have written proper pseudocode, the function of binary search algorithm.